Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to see, well, almost see, such a broad array of faculty, staff, students, members of the community, and others who I saw coming into the room a little earlier. I especially want to acknowledge Mayor Alboro of the city of San Rafael for his attendance here today. This is my 23rd year as president of this university. It's been a terrific run for a long time. And now I have the honor of being part of the group that's going to present to you the ninth president of this university. I've spent some time with Mary, and I know her to be a woman of great vigor and creativity, of vision, and dynamic leadership. She will make us all extraordinarily proud as we move forward. And speaking of being proud, let me introduce you to the chairman of the Board of Trustees, John Golding.
Thank you, Joseph. Let me add my warm welcome to this remarkable campus community. It's energetic, it's committed, it's diverse, it's driven to achieve, and we're all enriched by the spirit and the sheer beauty of this place we call Dominican. Today we begin the process of leadership transition, an exciting journey that will take us to a new place of our own design, a vision of our future as a small but very distinctive comprehensive institute of higher education. That vision has been evolving rapidly over the last 3 years, thanks to our leadership and other devoted members of our community, and will simply add more magic to this very special place. Over the next few weeks, we will also celebrate more than two decades of exceptional leadership of Dr. Joseph Fink as he brings his tenure as Dominican's president to a close. You need only look around you to see the tangible evidence of his contributions to our community. 2,200 fellow students, Conlon Recreation Center, Magnolia House, Edge Hill, a spectacular science building, new dormitories, and an environment that is both vibrant and at the same time tranquil and peaceful. We look at NC2A Division II. We see the first endowed chair in the chemistry department. We see so many places where Joe's footprints have created a legacy that will be both difficult to fill, but also imperative to honor. You can only imagine then the challenge that we faced to find the right, well, not exactly the right, but rather the perfect new leader in whose outstanding hands we could confidently place our future. We have found such a person, a remarkable, distinguished scholar, a proven leader, and a warm and engaging person who makes us feel like she's been part of us all along. Her name is Dr. Mary Marcy, and she joins us from Bard College at Simon's Rock in Western Massachusetts, where she was the chief executive of this very innovative and autonomous campus of Bard College in New York. She will be introduced to you by Andy Borowski, my vice chairman of the board and the chair of our search committee. We owe Andy and his outstanding committee a huge debt of gratitude for the long hours and exceptionally positive results of this search, which has taken nearly 2 years. So let me ask Andy to say a few words about the search then, and to introduce you to our new president-elect, Dr. Mary Marcy. Thank you. Andy?
Good job. Thank you, John. It really is a pleasure to do this today. It's a culmination of, as John said, almost 2 years of work. And before I get started introducing Mary, I would first like to say a few words about the search process. We had a really remarkable search committee with representatives from the Board of Trustees, faculty, staff, student body, Dominican Sisters, and alumni. And I'd like to take a moment to express my gratitude to my fellow members and to let you know who they were. First, Timothy Blackburn, Mary Jane Burke, John Galding, Peter Jacoby, Denise Lucy, Katie McGovern, Sister Maureen McInerney, Rodney Peck, Amaya Powell Hodge, Sister Patricia Simpson, Harlan Stelmach, and Terry Toomey. It was an incredible experience to work with such a dedicated, hardworking, and cohesive group, who at every turn and at every decision put the best interest of the entire university first. The process took over 2 years to complete. Our responsibilities included selecting the search firm, which all by itself was an entire job, reviewing resumes, doing live interviews, and choosing the candidate that would best embody the attributes defined by the Board of Trustees with input from faculty, staff, students, alumni, the Dominican Sisters, and other interested parties. You may have all wondered why we kept the ongoing details of our search so confidential. The underlying reason for this confidentiality was to attract and interview the best candidates. Many of the candidates who were in very good positions where they were and would not have even interviewed had we had a public process. The search was extensive. From an original field of over 90 applicants, we brought 11 candidates in for personal interviews and 4 in for a second, longer round of interviews. By the time we completed interviewing our final 4 candidates, it became apparent that one candidate stood out above the rest, and that was Dr. Mary Marcy. She was the unanimous choice of the search committee. She impressed the search committee with her intelligence, vision, leadership skills, and strength of character. She has a proven track record in fundraising, developing a board, staying connected to the academic world, and working closely with faculties, students, and staff. At Bard, at Simon's Rock, she proved that she could take a good institution to new heights, helping it evolve and stay relevant in the changing world of education. Beyond her ability to lead and make an institution grow in stature, Mary herself has a long and distinguished record as a scholar, leader, and engaged member of the higher education community. She has been prolific in her scholarly and popular articles on the important issues of our day and knows the challenges and opportunities that are ahead for higher education institutions. She has served as provost of Bard College at Simon's Rock and vice president at Bard College since 2004. As the chief operating officer at Simon's Rock, she has been responsible for all aspects of the academic and financial health of the college, as well as the college's relationship with its board of overseers. Under her leadership, Bard College at Simon's Rock strengthened its academic core, diversified the campus community, realized success in fundraising, and achieved increasing selectivity in student enrollment. During her tenure, the college's endowment realized dramatic growth, largely due to success in securing dedicated gifts to support student scholarships and faculty development. Prior to her role at Bard College, Mary worked in both public and private institutions of higher education. Her experience includes serving as the first dean of university relations and planning at Antioch University, Seattle, and serving as the lead researcher and policy advisor to the president of Western Washington University. Mary is a political scientist with a doctorate of philosophy and master of philosophy from the University of Oxford. She was born and raised on a ranch in Western Nebraska and received her Bachelor of Arts with honors from the University of Nebraska. If any of you would like more extensive information on our new leader, I would encourage you to visit Dominican's website. There you will find additional background and also be able to view her video commentary on a wide range of topics of importance to Dominican University that reflect her affinity for the values that define our culture. Ladies and gentlemen, faculty, students, alumni, trustees, Dominican sisters, and honored guests, it is my pleasure to introduce our next president, Dr. Mary Marcy.
Wow. And you don't even know me yet. That's great. Thank you. I'm thrilled and I'm honored to be standing on the stage today at this exceptional university. And I wanted to thank Andy and John for orchestrating this process, and President Fink for being so gracious as we begin to plan what will be a transition, an important transition for the university, and certainly an important personal transition as well. The search committee, while it worked quietly, I think on the university campus, worked very actively, and you need to know that they represented the university extraordinarily well, and that I got a very good feel for the institution through them. And the next stage in our conversation and me getting to know the university will be, I think, in talking with all of you in groups and individually so that I can begin to understand more thoroughly the history and the future of Dominican University of California. This day and in the next few days is really a chance to be introduced formally and informally, which means you know a bit about me and you know what you can find on the internet, which I hope is okay. We'll talk a little bit more in person, but I wanted you to understand some of my background and what attracted me to Dominican and to this very particular opportunity. As Andy said, I was born on a ranch in western Nebraska. I actually did begin my educational career in one of those one-room country schoolhouses. I began it there with a family that believed deeply in the power and the importance of education and sent five children to the University of Nebraska. My first trip abroad was actually to graduate school to the University of Oxford. And the world began to change very dramatically for me after that. I found my profession, my vocation, and my avocation in education because I believed personally, and I've seen socially and through public policy, that education is still the surest means of personal and social transformation in the world. I believe that deeply, and it means, and you will see in my career, that I am strongly attracted to mission-driven institutions, institutions that have a particular role to play in the landscape of American education. That's a lot of what attracted me to Dominican. Let me tell you a little bit about what I see, because when you work as hard as I know you all do every day on a campus, you sometimes don't know how you look to the outside world. Well, I can tell you you look great, but let me tell you some details. One of the things I noticed right away about Dominican was that it was an institution with a profound and important history that had also innovated. And I don't know if you realize that that's somewhat unusual in higher education. Sometimes institutions are so attached to their history that change is very difficult, and we don't keep up with current ideas and current new opportunities. And sometimes institutions are so busy chasing the new opportunity that they forget their identity. What I saw here was an institution that understood and valued not only its own history, but its sense of identity, to carry forward those original ideals of scholarship, study, reflection, community, and service. What a wonderful articulation of the power of the mind and the power of community to develop not only an institution, to make a difference in the world. That was a very powerful attraction to me. I also saw an institution that refused to make choices about false dichotomies. You have held on, as you should, to a belief in the liberal arts as a purest form of liberal education, education that liberates. At the same time, you've embraced thoughtful graduate programs and pre-professional programs, and you've built those two together so that a student who graduates from Dominican ultimately should be able to have mastery of some specific things and do them exceptionally well, and also be able to do anything because they've had the basis of a liberal arts education to think critically, to analyze, to read closely, to communicate. So you refuse to say we're only going to do one or the other, we're going to be a comprehensive university in the best possible sense at the graduate and undergraduate level. I'm attracted to the role that I believe Dominican has played and can play in its particular place in California in an American higher education. If you believe, as I do, that education can transform, then you believe, as I do, that there are few places in the country that are more in need of investment and access to higher education than California is right now. You have an important role to play here. As California goes through budget crises and changes, Dominican needs to stand at the forefront of higher education to talk about what is possible, to invest in the future, and to make a difference in the lives of students, faculty, and staff today. And finally, I was attracted to Dominican's commitment to student learning and to innovation in student learning. I had a number of conversations with the faculty on the search committee, and one of the things that impressed me was that every time we talked, even though there weren't students in the room, the student was at the center of the conversation. This is a place that believes in the value of education one student at a time, as well as in a broader philosophical commitment within the community. And I'm thrilled about that commitment, and I'm eager to help lead and be a part of that. And finally, as Andy mentioned, because the search process itself was closed, I thought I would talk a bit about the conversations I had with individuals on the search committee and some of the impressions that I had as a result of those conversations. Amaya, the president of your student body, was a member of the search committee, and you need to know that she showed up wearing Dominican colors. And she told me that in case I hadn't noticed, but I promise I had. And we talked about what a Dominican degree means to her now and what it will mean in 10 years and 20 years and what she wants it to mean. She's already thinking about not only her experience here, but the experience of students down the road, and she's going to be a great alum just as she's a great student leader now. I talked to Harlan and Denise as faculty members on the search committee, both within the committee itself and a couple of times after I knew I was the candidate that the university was interested in hiring. And as I said, I heard students at the center of that conversation, but I also heard the challenges and the opportunities that happen for faculty all over the country right now about workload and the need for investment and the belief that we need to hold on to our values even as we change and new programs are added. That's the beginning of what I hope will be and believe will be a long and productive conversation with faculty. I also had a chance to talk to some of the faculty leadership this morning, and I'm already learning a lot. It's very helpful. Terry Toomey from the staff served on the search committee, and as you all know, he's smart and vibrant and excited about being Dominican himself because he hasn't been here that long. And Terry and I talked about how staff are motivated and the similarities and differences in supporting staff, given that their career paths are different from faculty, and the importance of community, particularly at a place like Dominican. The alumni on the board, including Mary Jane Burke, who's also is on the board, was on the search committee and is alum, talked to me about her experience here at Dominican, what's changed, and equally important, what hasn't changed and what shouldn't change, so that we make sure that the mission and the values of this institution remain true even as we evolve with the times. A number of members of the board were on the search committee, and the thing that was most notable to me about these representatives was that many of them are not alums, and that's unusual. Often board members are made up primarily of alums. What that said to me is that Dominican's educational idea and innovation is powerful enough to attract smart, thoughtful people to the board and to investment in this institution beyond its natural constituency. And that's a profound statement and an important statement. And I met several representatives of the sisters, both through the search committee and a little bit later on through the selection committee. And I was deeply moved by those conversations because what I understood is that this is a group of people who literally on faith founded an educational institution as part of their service to the world. And that is what they're most interested in carrying forward as their legacy. It will be an honor and a pleasure to build on that legacy. I have some history of inheriting institutions after long-serving and strong leadership, and I see this transition at Dominican as building on long-serving and strong leadership both through President Fink and through the long heritage of leadership and educational innovation and contribution that Dominican University of California has offered. I'm honored, I'm thrilled, and I'm eager to meet many of you in a more personal way. Thank you.
I hate to tell you all this, but I think we're finished for, for this. So thank you all for attending. Actually, we wanted to have the mayor of San Rafael, Mayor Boro, come up. You have to understand, I live in Maine most of the time, so.
Well, I'll just be very brief because I know that you need to be on your way, but I just want to first of all welcome our new president, Dr. Marcy. I did receive a copy this morning of the press release. I was very impressed with it. I have a lot of interest in this university. First of all, from a city point of view, this is the only university in the county. We're very, very proud of this university. Also, I'm a neighbor. I live here in Dominican. So I go by here every day, and I've seen the transformation of this school. Since Dr. Fink has been here, he and I have been on kind of a path together. He's been here 23 years. I've been on our council 24. And so we've kind of gone hand in hand. We've enjoyed some of the changes. We had some issues with the changes. But they were all for the best. So, Joe, I want to thank you personally for all you've done for this university. And Dr. Marcy, wish you much success in the future.
Okay, we're done.
That's right.